Okay, I will make a short presentation mainly driven to those that are not expert in artificial intelligence, just to provide some insights about what is AI. So AI mainly is that to allow machines to do things that before were done by people, and at the same time, we have a lot of AI inside our mobiles, inside our pockets. So when we are talking to the mobile, we are using artificial intelligence techniques in order to allow the transformation from the voice into the text. When we do some queries, for instance, to Google, and in order to translate from one language into another, we are also using AI. If I talk and I ask you about which one is the name of the first chatbot, so probably many of you would say it is Siri or it is Tai or Eugene. However, the first chatbot was Elisa. And if we go into when Elisa was built, in that case, the answer was in 1964. So this implies that AI has been here for we started to do research in AI. In some people started. I wasn't born at this age, but many people, some people started to do AI in the second half of the century. So we should go back into the Turing test and the imitation game. In 1950, I mean, Turing proposed that a person, the human questioner, is doing some questions to a machine and to a human respondent, and if the person is not able to distinguish the man from the machine, then the system is doing an intelligent behavior. So this is the way in which Turing proposed the imitation game. And later on in the Dartmouth College, I mean, and I highly recommend to read the formulation, which is already in this website in Stanford. The parents, the fathers of the AI, they propose that a machine should have or should perform some kind of behavior that at this moment was only devoted to human beings. So mainly activities mainly related with learning and being able of carrying out any kind of intelligence up to now being performed by humans. And they point out some topics that are right now still topics of research, like use of language to manipulate words, automatic computing, self-improving, abstraction from sensory and other data, and also randomness and creativity. So these are some kind of features that should be present in artificial intelligence systems and devices. So these are the names of the fathers of AI. So you have the slides, and this stuff is being recorded, so you can later on go through them. And there are several definitions of AI, and I took this definition from the Russell and Norvin book in 95. So there they compare if systems that are able to think or act as humans, and also systems that are able to think and also act rationally. So let's see with some example what this is about. So the first one is, if we are talking about systems that think as human, what we are talking is about creating some kind of computational models and being able of building some kind of machines with minds. And if we start talking about systems that think rationally, then we are talking about the use of these computational models in applications. And it is supposed that these systems should provide the right artificial reasoning. If we go into the definition of system that act as human, then these systems should be able of reasoning, scheduling, learning, understanding, talking, translating from one language into another. And finally, if we go into the system that act rationally, then we are thinking about some kind of automation of human behavior. So we are talking, for instance, about systems that perceive the real world, do some kind of reasoning, also make a kind of decision making, and finally they perform some actions. So we can simplify through these images of drones just seeding some fields, or drones just delivering some kind of products some kind of products. So we also have two types of artificial intelligence. One is the general AI, and in that sense we are trying to build, or it is supposed that at some point in time we will have systems with a similar intelligence as the human being has, and being able of learn by themselves, and also being able of simulating complex processes. And when we are talking about a specific AI, then we are talking about AI being applied to solve particular and specific problems. So for instance, a system which is able of seeding some fields, or translating from one language into another. And there are some papers where they see how combining a specific AI we can reach, I don't know when, the general AI by combination and integration and fusion of particular AI-specific systems. If we go into the AI timeline, this is this picture is very well known. I mean, we started in the 50s. We have the AI winter in 97. We got the Deep Blue and the IBM computer just winning Kasparov, and at the end of the last century we started with more clever robots. And it was mainly in 2000, after 2010, with Siri, Watson, and several chatbots, where the increase of the popularity of AI started. So, and why does it happen? So let's see the main ingredients that we have for an artificial intelligence systems. So we need this. We have these four kind of ingredients, which are the infrastructure, the algorithms, and models, the data, and the users. And if we analyze during the winter, what we have were machines with limited capabilities. Mainly, most of the application were using a limited set of data, so we were doing experimentation with toy problems, and then the emphasis mainly in the research community were in the models and in the algorithms. At the end of the last century, we got bigger and infrastructure, being able of processing more amounts of data, being able of processing real-time data, and at some point in time, we moved into the big data era. And just because of that, you can see in the second picture that infrastructures are more relevant, and then we started to deal with more complex problems. And finally, just when we got all these two web two out application and a lot of sensors and Internet of Things around, then we started to collect big and huge amount of data. So at the end, these data are given by many people using many a kind of application and also devices. They are providing data, but also they are providing a lot of metadata, which are also important. And all this data and all these things are connected. And just because of that, we are moving into this kind of multidisciplinary scenarios where we can combine data from heterogeneous and multiple sources. So then in this picture, so you can see again how the emphasis and the hype of the AI came just because of this of this evolution in the technology, in the infrastructure, in the infrastructure, and then later on in the data and users. We also have two grants in artificial intelligence. We have the symbolic part and also the subsymbolic the symbolic part. In the symbolic part, we are trying to represent knowledge using rules, using logic, using ontologies. The symbolic part is also dealing with natural language processing. We will have several talks today about that, searching algorithms, while the subsymbolic part is oriented to machine learning, deep learning, neural network, and neural nets and connections. And both of them has pros and cons. Some of them require big data, like the case of the subsymbolic approach and machine learning approach. And the other part of the AI, which is the symbolic part, it is easier to debug and also to explain and also to provide control over the application. And in that case, big data is not needed. So in the symbolic part, we the system reasons in the way which is closer to the way in which human beings do the reasoning. And both has pros and cons, and probably the solution will come by integration on both parts. And just to represent in a picture, so this is the subsymbolic, we are doing models like that, and in the subsymbolic, I mean, these are the pictures that you will see today in the talk, just to provide an insight, just to identify if we are, or if the talks talk about symbolic or subsymbolic. So there are many areas of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence goes beyond machine learning and deep learning. We know that in the press and in the news, always artificial intelligence is equal to machine learning, and we know that there are more things. We have techniques related with knowledge representation and reasoning, heuristic search, machine learning and deep learning, of course, image recognition, language technologies, collective intelligence, query answering system, cognitive systems, robotics, edge AI, and so on and so forth. So artificial intelligence, there are many topics around. And just to provide you some insights, sometimes today we will talk about knowledge extraction from test. So this implies that computers are able to know, I mean, what the test is about, and to discover the words or the main meaning behind the test, and using machine learning and natural language processing techniques, from this bag of terms, we are able to build taxonomies, and later on, we are able to build the ontologies, and also. We can, from in the same way that we extract knowledge and concepts from test, we are also able to extract data from test and represent in knowledge graphs, and then start moving through the data instead of start moving through the documents. Another field is related with the search and search algorithms, where we are exploring the space of solution. And in the all shared algorithms, suppose that we have the board of chess, so the computer would go through the space of solutions, and then the computer would analyze how the human being would answer, and then the computer again, and then the human being, and by analyzing this space, we are able, using some mathematical functions, to identify how good or bad are these stages in the game, and the system would make a solution. They would make a move. So by analyzing and exploring the space of solution, the system can discover that this is a good move, and then the system would execute only this rule. So in that case, the human being could answer any of the three, but in that case, the computer has identified that this is the best option in this set of options that are already possible. And of course, the search algorithms has already evolved a lot just because of the deep learning and machine learning. And as an example, we have the AlphaGo, and where the DeepMind people used the advanced deep neural networks in order to to build the system that was able to win one of the most famous Go player. And the good thing is that the system was able to explore movements, also analyze options, and also inventing new moves that was not foreseen before by the experts. And also the Alpha Zero, which is for playing chess, where the system was able to learn without any kind of previous knowledge how to play chess. So in that case, 5 million matches were already analyzed in 4 hours. That was equivalent to 1,400 years of knowledge. Okay, so this implies that we in artificial intelligence, most of the time we start challenges just using games, and in the same way that Deep Blue was an important challenge in 97. So these are two important challenges and outcomes that were achieved recently. We also have image recognition in real time. So this is part of the work that we are doing here at UPM in the center in the AI innovation space, the joint center that we have with Accenture, where we are able to identify in real time objects and in different settings. We also know that artificial intelligence is applied for voice listener, and this has some issues with the privacy. So if we have Alexa and we have Chris for the digital assistance on the car or even the city, I mean, all these systems are recording, and then there are some insights about how it affects our privacy, because they are continuously learning, hearing us, and also there was a debate on press, just because if there were some people analyzing what we were already saying. So there are other devices that also knows about us and what we do at home. So there are devices that, based on the electric consumption, they are able to know if how many times we put the oven or the washing machine, or how many fridge we have at home. And another important asset is Watson cognitive system. So Watson was a program built by a system built by IBM. I mean, these people from IBM already and made Watson to compete in the Jeopardy program, and very successfully. So this was an important milestone in 2011. And also we have all this stuff related to artificial intelligence and embedded and also associated to robots. And just because of that, at UPM we have already decided to put the artificial intelligence strategy together with the robotics strategy. So we have robots, which are cars that drive, robots that are ground robots being used for agriculture, in health, and drones, a kind of aerial robots too. So at the end, artificial intelligence is being used in any kind of sector, public sector, education, business and companies, and also by the whole society. I have already put there several of them. We can use for climate and protection, and also protection of the environment, and in that way aligning with the sustainable development goals, and also for other issues, as has been already mentioned and will be mentioned today. So there are, as already presented by Cecile, there are several national AI strategies. So this is discovered until 2018. The Spanish strategy was already developed and delivered at the end of March 2019, and now we are waiting for funds for that. And I would like to mention and say that it is very important and to align AI research with regards to the sustainable development goals, because these settings are providing us a lot of use cases for innovation. And the digital technologies is and artificial intelligence and robotics in particular are at the core of the 17th development goals, because with the digital technologies we will be able of reaching this goal quicker and faster, and artificial intelligence, robotics, and also regulation and ethics, all this stuff should be worked together. And in particular, all the stuff related with language technologies and multilingualism, as in that case, it's really important for the European research, just because of the heterogeneities in languages that we have in Europe. So this is a case. I'm running out of time, but in the case of sustainable cities, I mean, in the cities, there are many ecosystems. There are many areas in which and sectors in which artificial intelligence can be applied. Data interoperability is a must between all these applications, devices, these systems, people that are interacted in the city. And finally, to conclude, because we will talk later today, it's very important to be compliant with the GDPR, and also to follow the ethics guidelines for the trustful AI, and also there are several ethics principles already, like the Asilomar and also the Toronto Declaration. So the debate of today, and it will be raised through the different talks, are mainly related with how robust the AI applications and systems that we build, how robust they are, because we need systems that are safe and secure, and in case of failure, we should be able of explaining why a failure occur. Remember that the in the symbolic part it is easier to explain things than in the sub-symbolic part. We also need systems being auditable, in the sense that in case of being too hard, I mean, we should be able, I mean, someone should be able of saying who is the responsible or why the failure occur and who is responsible of that. The other thing is which kind of human values we want to have in AI system, and how the AI system contribute to the prosperity of many peoples, and not only of those that have developed the artificial intelligence systems. We also need to adapt and also I would say to develop new rules. And to explore how the legal system is going to deal with the AI solutions and problems, and definitely, I mean, what we need is to have clear rules about how to manage the risk associated, the potential risk associated to the AI, but at the same time to tell citizens and the market that we can use AI in safely and safety conditions. So thank you very much, and we